Good evening and welcome to this Good Friday service. You have come knowing the full well, the weight of the story that you're joining, and yet you have come. I hope you've come with open hearts and open minds for what the Spirit longs to do in each of our lives. The story this evening is about abandonment and unrest, accusations and assaults, crucifixion and burial. I'm glad we're on this side of history, but it's Friday. As we listen to the story again, let's be open to the power that it offers.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "My soul is deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
We were meant to walk in the garden with God and with one another without shame. And yet, we learned the way of separation, the way of ego preservation, and a belief that in our own will to power, we can actually know life and safety. And so on this night, having finished the Passover meal, a reminder of the freedom where God brought the Israelites from Egypt and brought them out of slavery. It's the reminder that Jesus as the new Messiah, the new Moses, the one who would lead us into the fullness of freedom for which we were born. Here, Jesus passes through death into life by way of the garden. Here, he prays and he pleads, asking if there is another way for us all to get home. And as the milk and the honey represent, God is in the business of getting us all to the promised land, to the place of abundance and life, where we all get to walk in these skins without shame, with God, and with one another. It is a place of life. So tonight, let us stay awake. Let us awaken to the presence and the call of Jesus in the garden. Let us awaken to the garden life for which we were formed and destined. Let us stay awake with Jesus and follow him into the darkness of this night that we might with him find life and home in the garden of God's love and peace once more. Let us go to the garden.
Lord,
Immediately while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to Jesus at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a rebel? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled. All of them deserted him and fled."
The events of this fateful night are rapidly unfolding. Having departed the upper room with the 11, Jesus had made his way to the Garden of Gethsemane. Knowing what was soon to come, Jesus spent some intimate time in prayer with his Heavenly Father. We cannot imagine the emotion and burden Jesus must have felt in those moments. Judas, one of the 12, knew where Jesus would go with the disciples following the Passover meal. Having agreed to betray the Lord for 30 pieces of silver, Judas led those assembled by the Sanhedrin to arrest Jesus and bring him before the council to stand trial. Our text deals with the betrayal and the arrest of Jesus. For me, this is one of the saddest passages of all Scripture. One should have recognized Jesus and trusted him as the Christ, abandoned him, and agreed to betray him for a few pieces of silver. Mark's gospel says a great crowd came for Jesus. Why were there so many involved? Why were they so heavily armed? What were they so afraid of? What were they so mad about? What had he done to deserve this treatment? But earlier in Scripture, the Jewish religious leaders had determined they needed to kill Jesus. But what kept them from acting was his popularity and the impact he was having on so many. So these religious leaders needed a way to capture Jesus when no crowd of followers would be around. A crowd that might cause a disruption or a riot if they arrested him in public. So they came with overwhelming might when they had the opportunity to seize Jesus without challenge. Judas alerted the Sanhedrin when he determined that Jesus and the other 11 apostles would be at that garden spot. Once everyone was well armed and ready to act, he led them to where Jesus was. Judas had prearranged a signal so that in the dark they would capture the right man. A kiss, a light kiss on the cheek, was a customary greeting for a friend or someone highly respected, which is still common in many cultures. No one would have thought that unusual.
But Judas and Jesus knew. They knew that this was not a kiss of affection, but a kiss of betrayal. What had changed? Mark tells us that there was no hesitation on Judas' part. Judas went immediately to Jesus, kissed him so that the mob could quickly apprehend him. But Jesus offered no resistance, so he was quickly and easily apprehended and arrested. Mark records only one attempt at a feeble resistance. He doesn't name who cut off the high priest's servant's ear, but John's gospel tells us it was Peter. Luke's gospel reports that Jesus instantly healed that servant's ear. Was this not Jesus' way? Was this not Jesus' way of offering a different way, a real hope, by leading in peace? Jesus doesn't resist in the least, but does object to the way they came. They came heavily armed in the middle of the night in an isolated place where they could have captured him at any time while he was teaching in the temple. They arrested him like a common criminal. Yet there was an ultimate divine purpose in these actions. As Jesus explains, it was so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. Coming to fruition were the words of the prophets and God's promises. The disciples scattered when it became clear that Jesus would offer no resistance. Peter and company had to be confused in those moments. The Messianic tradition said that the Messiah would return to free Israel from the oppression it was suffering and place a descendant of King David on the throne. They were sure this wasn't going to happen now. From their point of view, it was all over. Their leader was in custody, so they could not fully grasp the situation. No wonder one of them lashed out in violence. Our passage tells us they fled. They all fled. Interesting, the location of the word all in this verse from the Greek is known as an emphatic, indicating that Mark was emphasizing the word all in the same way we would emphasize the word by putting it in all caps. They all deserted him. Jesus was all alone now to face his sufferings. He was forsaken and alone to do what he alone could do for humanity. Friends, as difficult as it is to recount these events and wonder how we might have participated that night, the Jesus movement survives because of Jesus' choices that night. Jesus' message of love and peace have persevered through the centuries because it is based on Jesus' commitment to love and peace, not war, not might, not force. The movement continues today in us and through us when Jesus' followers seek to live the life exemplified in Jesus' life, death, and ultimate resurrection. Friends, we may flee if we choose, because it's hard to be faithful today. But this is what it takes to know the change in this world and in the lives we pray for.
Cozy, cozy, yeah.
They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'" But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him and beat him. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify.
And so we come to the political part of the story. The chief priest and his colleagues had already decided to kill Jesus. Now they just needed to work it through the system. And so they started. First, they got all of the chief priests, the high priest and others, the elders, the scribes, they were all assembled. We want them all here because if they're all here, they can't tell us later we shouldn't have done what we did. So we'll have, it's like the old smoke-filled room. I don't know if their room was smoke-filled or not, but the same kinds of things were being decided there that used to be decided in the smoke-filled room. We'll all talk about it, and we'll get one another to agree. We've all got to say the same thing. We can't have dissension among us. We have to believe the lie, and then we have to repeat the lie, and then we have to get others to believe the lie too. So they got together a number of people to bear false testimony, and they couldn't even agree on that. You know, there's an old saying, I know you think you understood what you thought I said, but what you don't realize is that what you heard is not what I meant. And I think that's the case with Jesus. He often spoke in parables, things that were a little difficult to understand, and people literally heard it differently. And then they'd talk and they'd listen more and eventually come to understand what he meant. He sort of said something like that, but it wasn't something that would get him killed. It was just a truth that he knew that no one else did. And as they were accusing him, he didn't say anything until he did. They were accusing him, and they said, well, tell us, are you the Messiah? Finally, he said the shortest, truest thing. I am. And then even Jesus couldn't help himself. He had to elaborate just a little bit. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven. I am would have been enough. That's what got him actually in trouble. But he just had to, well, stick it to them just a little bit. It's not just I think I am, I am. And you'll learn later what that actually means. So they brought Jesus to the authorities. They made it official. Later on in Mark's chapter 15, all the Sanhedrin were together. Get the whole group together before we present it to the people. And let's, if we can't pile on the evidence, let's pile on the accusations. One lie is okay, two is better, three, 12, 14, 21, the more the better. Let's pile on the lies. If they believe the one, they'll believe the others. Or they'll think, well, there's enough there somewhere. And that's what happened. So then the soldiers got to him. You have our permission to do whatever you like. And they, how do I say it? They were good at their job. All the people were there, and they put a purple cloak on him. A sign of royalty. And then they twisted a crown of thorns together and they put it on him. And they began saluting him, all of it only in mocking, cruel taunting. And they knelt down in homage to him. What a farce! What a farce! They stripped him of the purple cloak, put his own clothes on him, and then they led him out to crucify him. All of this drama, all of this farce, simply in preparation for his death.
Because of that. was like the parting of day and night. A song was the suffering born by the body of Mary's Son. But sorer still to him was the grief which for his sake
they compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two rebels, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others, he can't save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let's see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man is God's son."
To be forsaken. Pause and feel that. To be forsaken. Have you known betrayal? Have you known what it is to feel alone, to feel unseen, that you are without friend or safe shelter? Part of the power of the crucifixion story is that Jesus, Emmanuel, God who is with us, knows this place. This feeling and experience of being betrayed, of being abused,
of being mocked, of being tortured, of being killed. God, where are you? We cry. God, have you forsaken me? God, have you forsaken us? Jesus, God with us, knows what it is to be forsaken, what it is to suffer. Yes, this is how God comes. Not with a crown of jewels or as a conquering warlord. No, but as the one who knows suffering and endured a crown of thorns. Jesus, one who was crucified with nails. God, where are you? God, have you forsaken me? Have you forsaken us? Jesus, the one who was forsaken. It is here that God shows up, here that the Son of God is affirmed. And it is here, in this night, that we become reborn. As we know the God who not only suffers with us, but the God who hears our cries and is with us in the darkest of nights. When we cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? God has been there. And God is with us. With us in our suffering, with those who suffer around the world. For Jesus himself cried, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then he gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And now the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, and he said, truly, this man was God's son. Oh, Jesus, be with us now as we long for your resurrection, as we look for the life that you have promised, and we find ourselves reborn.
Now receive this benediction. We come, O Lord, in the darkness today. We leave, O Lord, in the darkness tonight. May we meet you in the darkness as we wait for the light. Amen.
When you come in.
For if you lead me, I cannot stray. Lord, let me walk each day.